So let us now take up the last part of this discussion. Now, as I said, we will, in this session, primarily discuss the debates between, say, Habermas and Lyotard, all French post-structuralists, then Habermas and Foucault, and Habermas and Derrida. But before I go into these debates, just one or two things I think should be stated. That is, methodologically, how should we look at Habermas? Habermas, I have not yet mentioned this point. Habermas, if one looks at Habermas's writings, his interviews, his observations on various themes, then one finds Habermas has a very strong inclination towards Max Weber. Habermas, in fact, in one of his interviews, has mentioned a very interesting expression: Weberian Marxism. That is, I believe in a kind of, or I subscribe to a kind of Weberian Marxism. Now, this may sound a bit strange, because Weber and Marx, how do you combine the two? In fact, there is a saying about Weber that I do not know whether it's how authentic it is, that Max Weber once perhaps made a statement like this, that throughout my life I have fought an invisible duel with Karl Marx. So if that be so, so how can you talk of Weberian Marxism? So Weber is one major methodological source so far as Habermas is concerned. And the other is Kant. Kant is another very important source. Now, let me very briefly elaborate these two points before I go into the discussion of the debates. Now, Weber actually, if we look at his writings, then one finds Weber's outlook is marked by two very interesting features. And these two features, to a large extent, very broadly explain, perhaps, Habermas's such strong inclination towards Weber, or Habermas's respect for Weber. One is, Weber, to some extent, like the Frankfurt theorists. Of course, Weber died much before the Frankfurt School took off in 1923. But Weber already, in his writings, was quite sharply skeptical of the claims of reason. That is, the Enlightenment reasoning, well, that will lead to bureaucratization, and a very pessimistic portrayal of the future. So this is something that characterized Max Weber. This is one point, which of course had an impact on Habermas. And the other thing is that Weber methodologically focuses on this notion of intersubjectivity. That is, when he talks of interpretative understanding, this famous German word Verstehen, so that interpretative understanding, well, that is basically, or symbolically, it actually refers to the idea of communication of or communication underlying the notion of, or the spirit of intersubjectivity. And this whole idea of interpretation, actually, this whole tradition in German philosophy, Max Weber, later the Frankfurt School theorists, they all flow from a debate, very famous debate, that took place in 19th century Germany, the debate which was initiated by Wilhelm Dilthey, that is the debate concerning two rival claims. One is natural sciences, the claim of natural science, the other is the claim of human science. That is, natural science aims at explanation, causal explanation, whereas human sciences aim at interpretative understanding. And when you go for interpretative understanding, then you have to think in terms of intersubjective communication, intersubjective, say, dialogue, this kind of. This whole notion of intersubjectivity actually follows from that. So this is one issue, that is Habermas and the impact of Weber, methodological impact of Weber on Habermas. The other is Kant. Now, of course, Habermas is quite strongly inclined towards the Enlightenment tradition. And so far as the Enlightenment tradition is concerned, yes, he definitely is influenced by the ideas of Kant, by the ideas of Hegel. But if one makes a comparison of Kant and Hegel, then it is quite evident that if one uses an expression like this, that Habermas is more Kantian than Hegelian. Because so far as Hegel is concerned, this all-encompassing power of reason, that is, reason explains everything. And reason actually traps you. Reason, there is nothing beyond the comprehension of reason. Everything can be explained in terms of reason. Now, this all-powerful understanding of reason, apparently, one may say, well, this was also Habermas's understanding. Habermas also was guided by this spirit of enlightenment with its focus on reason, all-pervasive power of reason. Apparently, it's like this. But Habermas also, while talking of reason, while talking of the power of reason, while acknowledging or recognizing the power of or authority of reason, Habermas also is very strongly inclined towards defense of autonomy of the human mind. So this autonomy of human mind, that is the central point of Kant. And this notion of autonomy, well, this is something which Habermas does not want to say sacrifice. So that way, and this point I will very briefly explain when we now go into the debates between, say, Habermas and Diosdar, Habermas and Foucault particularly, and Derrida and Habermas. Now, so far as the first debate is concerned, all these debates have some very interesting contexts. So Habermas-Lyotard debate, one of the earliest debates, the background is something like this. That is, in the year 1980, in Frankfurt, on the occasion of Habermas's, actually it was a kind of, say, function where Habermas was awarded the Theodore Adorno Prize. So on that occasion in Frankfurt, Habermas delivered a lecture, that is Modernity and Incomplete Project, very famous essay of Habermas. Later, this essay has been reproduced in many volumes, but this is actually the background. That is, in 1980, in Frankfurt, on the occasion of this award of Adorno Prize, Habermas delivered this lecture. And it was published in the year 1981. And it is this theme, actually, which Habermas initially presented in 1980. This theme was later elaborated by Habermas, say, in his very famous book. Actually, it's not a book. Actually, it's a collection of 12 lectures. That is, A Philosophical Discourse of Modernity, published in 1985. It's actually a collection of 12 lectures delivered by Habermas in Frankfurt. So in those lectures also, Habermas does not directly talk about Lyotard, but in these lectures, there are at least three lectures, two lectures on Foucault, one lecture on Derrida. But throughout the book, Habermas has again and again gone back to this theme, that is, modernity and incomplete project. Now, I'm just giving you the background, the setting. After this essay was published, François Lyotard, he came out with an essay, and the essay's title is very significant, answering the question, what is postmodernism? Published in April 1982. And perhaps it is not known to many of us that this essay, that is answering the question, what is postmodernism, this essay actually appeared as an appendix to Lyotard's very famous report, that is the Postmodern Condition Report on Knowledge in 1984, which is otherwise very well known. But this essay actually is a response to Habermas. So this is the background of Habermas-Lyotard debate. Now, in this debate, what actually are the arguments? The central argument of Habermas is this, and he uses very strong language. Very strong in the sense that Habermas, as I have mentioned earlier, Habermas in this lecture in Frankfurt, he lumps together Daniel Bell, then Foucault, Derrida, and all these people. And he describes them as neoconservatives because they are skeptical of the power of reason and thereby of the entire Enlightenment tradition. And Habermas's understanding is very simple, that yes, Enlightenment has many problems. I'm not at all convinced by the all-pervasive claims of reason under Enlightenment. But Enlightenment's notion of reason, it has to be reinvented. Because the power of reason, the potentiality of reason, as we come across under Enlightenment, that got lost. That got lost under capitalism. So capitalist modernity distorted the spirit of reason. It violated the spirit of reason. And therefore, if today we look for an alternative, we have to revive reason. And Enlightenment as such, there is nothing wrong about Enlightenment as such. But the spirit of Enlightenment, well, that has got to be revitalized. This is a very simple, very clear-cut argument of Habermas. And I'm just very interesting, where Habermas, I'm just quoting Habermas from this lecture. Should we try to hold on to the intentions of the Enlightenment, feeble as they may be, or should we declare the entire project of modernity a lost cause? This is the gist of Habermas's understanding. I now want to return to the problem. This is the second thing. This is the gist of Habermas's issue. And since Daniel Bell and others, they are skeptical of, they are dismissive of Enlightenment reason. That is, they just don't have any faith in the power of reason. So Habermas equally strongly calls them neoconservatives. Now, Lyotard, if you look at the thrust of the argument, you will understand how uncompromising the two positions are. Now, Lyotard, in his almost in the last para, last lines, let us wage a war on totality. Let us be witness to the unpresentable. Let us activate the differences and save the honor of the name. This is Lyotard. War on totality. And this is Lyotard's understanding. In fact, Habermas, quite sarcastically, while talking about this postmodern understanding, this postmodern is dismissal of totality, postmodern is defense of, say, contingency, postmodernism's defense of the notion of difference, instability. Habermas says that you are actually referring to a kind of terror, and that terror is the terror of reason. For the postmodernist, reason is the power of reason is actually the power of terror. And this is a kind of understanding which is absolutely unacceptable to Habermas. So Habermas, one has to be careful about this, that Habermas, however, is not unconditionally accepting enlightenment or enlightenment's power of reasoning. What Habermas is doing is that Habermas is accepting enlightenment with certain conditions, and that notion of reason he wants to combine with the strategy of hermeneutics, which I have discussed earlier. That is, he picks up from enlightenment the power of reason, he fuses it with the notion of hermeneutics, and arrives at the notion of universal pragmatics, consensus, dialogue, and this kind of, say, alternative blueprint. So this is about the Lyotard-Habermas debate. Now I come to the debate between Foucault and Habermas, but this is a bit more interesting. Bit more interesting in the sense that Habermas, as I said in his book, The Philosophical Discourse of Modernity, there are actually two lectures, lectures 9 and lecture 10. These are devoted to Foucault. Then there is a lecture number 11. That 11th lecture is very interesting, very significant. Especially significant for the title. The title is, and the title explains actually Habermas's, the difference between Habermas and Foucault. That is, subject-centered versus communicative reason. Habermas's reason is communication-based, communicative reason, whereas Foucault's understanding is of reason, that is the subject-centered reason. That is, Foucault's whole focus is on the subject of enlightenment, subjectivity, the dismissal of the subject, dismissal of the Cartesian notion of subject, etc., etc. Now, the interesting thing is that when Habermas, one can put it like this, at the end of, say, Foucault's career, that is, in Foucault's later writings, one comes across a shift. And that shift in Foucault's writings and Habermas's coinage of a particular term, Habermas's coinage of a particular, say, expression, these two shifts in Habermas's writings and in Foucault's writings, I'm not saying that they come very close to each other, but these shifts indicate that there is a possibility of linking Habermas and Foucault. possibility. I'm not saying that they just brought themselves very close to each other. First of all, Habermas, and then I come to Foucault. Habermas actually, in one of his interviews, he has explained it very lucidly. In his writings, it's not very clear, because Habermas has written so much and discussed so many things in so many different ways that it is difficult at times to exactly understand what he means. But in one or two of his interviews, especially, as I said, this book by Deuce, the first book which I, Peter Deuce's book, Habermas, the interviews. In some of these interviews, Habermas has been asked a question that you have used a coinage. It is called discourse ethics. So what exactly is meant by that? And what he means by that is, I would say, a kind of extension of his notion of universal pragmatics, but on the level of ethics. What he means by it is something like this. That is, if there is an act of injustice in society, then it is possible to arrive at an understanding of the norms of justice. And that possibility of arriving at norms of justice, well, that possibility can be realized if those who have been affected by the acts of injustice, well, they can arrive at, and he says that it is possible, they can arrive at a kind of rational consensus. But this rational, and here Kant comes into the picture. He says that this possibility of arriving at a kind of consensus on the issue of what is justice and what is injustice, and you actually prescribe that what is the norm of justice in such a situation, that is the consensus of the affected. The affected people, they all arrive at a shared norm of justice against an act of injustice. It is possible, he says. But it is possible by sharing a spirit of what Kant calls categorical imperative. But categorical imperative, normally, in the Kantian understanding, the categorical imperative is normally something subjective. I am guided by my moral consideration, by my notion of morality. Say, if I am traveling in a public transport, and I have quite often given this example in the classroom, say I am traveling in a public transport. Now, at one point I find that my co-passenger, he or she just gets down and leaving a money bag on my seat, and I just take a glance at the money bag, and I find that the money bag is full of, say, 1,000 rupee notes. So what to do in such a situation? Now, if I pick up the bag and I slip it into my pocket, nothing will happen. So I can do it. But whether I will do it or not, well, who will tell me what should I do? So it may be that I'm driven by my notion of categorical imperative, and I say, deposit it with the conductor. Or maybe I'm not moved by any such prompting, and so I just smartly walk down, picking up that money bag. So this notion of subjectivity is actually questioned by Habermas here. Habermas is talking of a possibility where, and this is what he called discourse ethics, that is a kind of collective arrival at an understanding of the norms of justice. And this consensus is arrived at through a dialogue, through a kind of, say, communication, through a kind of intersubjective communication, discussion, discourse, whatever you would like to call it. And that prescribes the notion of, say, justice. Justice prescribed by the affected against injustice. So, there you have actually a recognition of the Kantian notion of autonomy. That is, the whole thing is arriving out of your, or emerging out of this moral drive, a moral urge, that's the notion of categorical imperative. Now, Foucault, in his later writings, is talking of a kind of thing which is not there in Foucault's early writing. Foucault's early writings, we know, this is talking of power, then how power is constituted, etc., etc. I'm not going into that discussion. But in his later writings, Foucault is using the expression, and he, in fact, in his later writings, his books also carry a title like this, Care of the Self. Now, what is the focus of this kind of thing? There actually, what Foucault in these writings prescribes is a kind of, say, celebration of the self. Celebration, care, recognition of the self through certain practices which exclusively will be conducted by the self, by the individual. That is, what is happening here is actually a shift from Foucault's early emphasis on knowledge of the self to care of the self. That is a kind of recognition of the autonomy of the self. How I guard myself. And how, and in this understanding, Foucault is referring to ancient Greece, many practices conducted in ancient Greece, and through different practices, how I cultivate myself, how I protect myself, how I develop myself. And in the protection, cultivation, development, improvement, expansion of myself and selfhood, I am autonomous. So that way, this Kantian impact on Habermas and Foucault, I would simply say perhaps it opens up a possibility of, say, bringing them together. I'm not saying that they deliberately did it, or they, because Foucault died much earlier, Habermas is still very much alive. But had Foucault lived longer, maybe, I do not know, maybe they could have, say, entered into a kind of, perhaps, dialogue. Again, to pick up Habermas's phrase, a kind of intersubjective communication. Perhaps it would have been possible. I do not know, but the possibility is there. So far as Derrida is concerned, this is very interesting. In actually this work, Philosophical Discourse of Modernity, there is an essay, there is a lecture, I would say. There are all 12 lectures. There is a lecture on Derrida by Habermas. But that this work, actually, the Philosophical Discourse of Modernity, that was written in published in, I think, 1986, around that time, 86 or 87. But very recently, the book is in fact here on display. In the year 2003, after this 9/11 episode in the United States, one American scholar, Giovanna Boradori, she actually interviewed Derrida and Habermas, and the book is called Philosophy in a Time of Terror. very interesting book. And this book actually comprises two long dialogues. One dialogue with Habermas and the other dialogue with Derrida. Derrida's dialogue is rather longish. Habermas's dialogue is somewhat brief. And these two dialogues actually bring into focus a very central question. Of course, the two dialogues center around the 9/11 episode, their impression, their, say, observations on 9/11, the issue of fundamentalism, violence, terror, everything is there. But one central question which the two philosophers share, well, this is the question of enlightenment, European enlightenment, and this whole issue of modernity, etc. Now, if one looks at the two dialogues, one conducted by Habermas, the other conducted by Derrida, then one comes across a very interesting difference between the two, despite, however, a striking similarity. So I will very briefly just explain the gist of these two dialogues, so far as their observations on enlightenment, modernity, etc. are concerned. Now, as I said, there is apparently a striking similarity. The similarity is this. Derrida as well as Habermas share the understanding that they actually, the context is like this. What happened in Holocaust? Who is to blame for Holocaust? At one point in the dialogue, it is like this. And both of them agree, and both of them argue, that so far as the Holocaust is concerned, it is not enough simply to blame some individuals, some, say, persons who were in charge of gas chambers and concentration camp, that is, those who were their actual killers. It is not enough to blame them for the Holocaust. And Habermas is particularly sensitive on this question. He says that this notion of guilt, the notion of responsibility, well, it has to be shared by the entire German people. So we cannot say that it was just some misdeeds of some persons who were perhaps misled or anyway. So this is no excuse. But then what Habermas says is, and this is a point which is shared by Derrida also, on this point, that a larger question is involved in it. And since a larger question is involved, the answer also has to be placed in a larger context. The answer has to be sought in a larger context. And Habermas's understanding is something like this. I am just putting it through the gist, the essence of this, their difference. So far as Habermas is concerned, Habermas says that yes, it was an act of unreason, the whole Holocaust phenomenon. And similarly, any kind of, say, terrorist violence or attack, yes, it is an act of unreason. There is no doubt about that. And obviously, this 9/11 episode, it was an act of unreason. But if we have to think in terms of future, so that these acts of unreason are not conducted in future, then we have to think in terms of the possibility of replacement of acts of unreason by acts of reason. And these acts of reason, well, what are their sources? What are their origins? Where can you locate them? Where can you situate them? Where are the clues? And Habermas is very strongly convinced that yes, you get them in the European Enlightenment. That is, European Enlightenment gives you all these ideas. The idea of tolerance, the idea of balance, the idea of, say, democracy, everything. That is, Enlightenment reason has the possibilities, but it got blunted. That is, going back to this old theme, unfinished project of modernity. Modernity has remained an incomplete, unfinished project. It had possibilities, but it got distorted. So you cannot throw the baby away with the bathwater. So you have to make a distinction. So you must not blame Enlightenment. And Habermas very clearly states, among many other things, say, republican values, for example, then the importance of collective participation, the importance of constitution, democracy, liberal values, which make you civilized, actually, which make it possible for you to share a civilized life. So this is Habermas's understanding, and he makes it very clear that all these you get derive from the Enlightenment legacy. So there is nothing wrong with Enlightenment as such. But the way, these have not been properly used, that the way these have got distorted, for that you must not blame Enlightenment. Derrida's understanding is that, yes, as such I have no objection to what Habermas says or to this kind of logic. But the point is that all these notions, that is, the notion of republicanism, democracy, participation, etc., they require contextualization. They have to be understood in terms of their context. That is, they require deconstruction. They are not homogeneous universal concepts. This whole notion of, say, sharing certain universal values. As you know, this is the notion of modernity. That is, modernity universalizes certain things. Modernity essentializes certain things. So for Derrida, so these have to be de-essentialized. These have to be, say, de-homogenized. They have to be deconstructed. As such, I have no problem. But you must relate them to the context. So whether it is terror or violence or this or that, so you have to understand it like this. And this being the central difference between, so there is apparently a striking similarity between the two, but there is also a very sharp difference regarding the understanding of Enlightenment modernity. So as you see, these debates between, say, Habermas and Derrida, Habermas and Foucault, Habermas and Lyotard, they actually contained within them, say, the possibilities of looking into multiple directions so far as our understanding of modernity, our negotiation with modernity is concerned. Habermas is responding to all these people, these three people, in three different ways. I will finally end up this discussion by referring to just two things. One, I very briefly mentioned in the last session. Incidentally, I'll just forget. Incidentally, when Derrida is actually engaged in this dialogue on this 9/11 episode, perhaps many of you know about it, but I'm just repeating it, I think, to make keeping in mind the relevance of this expression. Habermas, in course of this conversation, at one point says that one of the major teachings of European Enlightenment is tolerance. Yes, tolerance, of course, is a very important liberal value which we have to accept. Derrida is skeptical of that notion. And Derrida makes a very insightful comment. In fact, Derrida has extended this point elsewhere. Many of you are perhaps aware of it. That Derrida refuses to accept the notion of tolerance really as a very important concept. He makes a difference between the notion of tolerance and the notion of hospitality. Because for Derrida, when you are talking of tolerance, tolerance is implied a notion of conditionality. I tolerate you means I tolerate you up to certain limit, up to certain level, thus far and no further. So you prescribe a limit. And in tolerance there is an element of hospitality involved, but that hospitality is actually a conditional hospitality. You are hospitable, you are welcome, but on these conditions. Whereas unconditional hospitality, that is actually the prescription of Derrida, where you do not require as such an invitation, you are just welcome. So no conditions are attached. In fact, in the present European crisis, this crisis emerging out of this Syrian refugees, well, I think this issue becomes very, very important. Had Derrida been alive today, I do not know how he would have responded to this question. Now I come to the last part, that is, I very briefly mentioned this episode, that is, on 31st May 2003, after this American invasion of Iraq, well, there came up a publication. It was widely publicized. It was a manifesto for European Renaissance. It was like this, Manifesto for European Renaissance. And it was drafted by Habermas and signed by, very interestingly, Derrida, Rorty, Umberto Eco. Eco was at that time alive. So all of them signed it. And it was actually a kind of manifesto which very strongly condemned this American invasion of Iraq. And it actually called for a kind of, say, assertion of Europe against this American move. So it was a kind of assertion of European identity. Europe versus America. Now, when Habermas, and it was actually a call for celebration of, say, defense of the values of humanism, reason, etc. So apparently there was nothing wrong about it. But this also created a controversy. I'm just putting before you what happened. So how you will respond to it, that is up to you. I'm not making any comment, but I'm just putting before you what happened. So after this manifesto was published, signed by Habermas and others, some comments came out. And the critical comments were like this, that after all, when you are espousing the cause of Europe against America, then what kind of Europe you are defending? It is Europe under neoliberalism. So defense of neoliberal Europe. So, and very strongly Eurocentric understanding, Europe versus America kind of thing. And as if Europe, it is defending, in the name of defense of, say, European values, it is defending the values of mankind, values shared, celebrated by mankind. So it's a very strong, say, Eurocentric
somewhat narrow understanding. So this kind of thing came up. And I end up by saying that after all these discussions, that is, Habermas is trying to put before us a kind of alternative blueprint, this dialogue, consensus. One can say, of course, it's a kind of utopia. But even if it is a utopia, and with that I will close, the question is, why Habermas still occupies a place of great importance? Why Habermas, again and again, well, he's been asked to make his observations on all these issues? I think there are two ways of responding to this question. One issue is that, well, what is utopia? Utopia, after all, is a kind of dream. And after all, if you cannot dream, maybe it's a utopian dream. Well, then how can you really think of realizing a great project, realizing your vision? Yet every vision has a dream behind it. A vision is a kind of dream. So, as such, I think nobody would disagree on this point. The vision as such, the dream as such, well, there is nothing wrong about it. That is, this whole notion of dialogue, consensus. Now, the point is, if conditions can be created to make this dream realizable, this is one, I think, point of enduring importance so far as Habermas is concerned. Howsoever utopian the project may look like. The other is that in a world ridden with so much of violence, when Habermas talks about this dialogue, consensus, I think it has a very important relevance today. Because after all, in our country also, we are talking of peace, we are talking of, say, some kind of agreement, especially at the time of, say, these elections and all these things. That is one point, I think, and I think that is the underlying spirit of any democratic system. Although Habermas himself does not make it very clear, in fact, it is not necessary for him. But in a country like India, I think that is very, very important. That is, if you have to make a democratic system functional, if you have to make a democratic system operational, then you have to agree on one point. There has to be a consensus on observance of certain rules and certain norms. If these rules and norms, there is fundamental disagreement on this point, then no democratic system can function. I think in countries like India, it's very, very important. That is, now, how do you arrive at this consensus? What are the rules of the game? Well, there may be difference on this point. But the necessity of arriving at a consensus on certain basic principles, on certain basic rules, on certain basic norms, if that is not accepted, then I think talking about democracy doesn't make any sense. So that way, I think when Habermas talks about, say, the importance of arriving at consensus, not only just importance, he says that this possibility is there. And Habermas pins his faith in the power of reason, rationality of the human mind. That it is possible, if we are rational, then it is possible for us to arrive at, to share a kind of consensus. What exactly those rules will look like, how in India they will operate, how they will operate in China, or how they will operate in, say, Myanmar, we do not know. But the basic principle, I think, that has been very rightly highlighted by Habermas. So with this, I close the discussion. We have still about half an hour to go, so we can. Yes, yes, please, please.
Sir, I have a comment and a question.
Sure.
First is that when you are, or we are saying that Habermas is, or Habermas's project is utopian, are we perhaps also missing the point that maybe there are contingent moments in history or contingent pockets in the narrative of the world where such a possibility of consensus is possible? This is my question number one. And the second question, which
will you please just repeat the question?
Is that if we say that Habermas's project is utopian, mm-hmm. don't you think that we are succumbing to a certain kind of a defeatist proposition instead of trying to understand if it is possible to see how the project may be successful at contingent pockets in history? Or maybe not, it is not pervasively successful, but maybe at contingent pockets in moments of history it is successful. The second question I'm still trying to frame, because it is more complicated than this, because when you're talking about the Derrida-Habermas debate, you spoke about an early Foucault and later Foucault. There is also a kind of the kind of two Derridas there as well. The one Derrida who is writing off grammatology, and the other Derrida who is writing or delivering a lecture called Cities of Refuge, where he is talking about how the city of refuge is a kind of an utopian space. Or, for example, when he's writing an essay like The Gift of Death, mm-hmm. where once again he's talking about responsibility towards the other. Or when he's talking about after Levinas's death, for example, he's writing this, he's giving this long lecture called Adieu, where the two sections, Welcome and Adieu, where he is talking about the complete, the infinite responsibility towards the other. So in my reading of these essays, I felt that there is a certain kind of a humanism, a certain kind of an enlightenment logic that Derrida is going back to, where there would be a perfect interface possible between Derrida and Habermas. Mm-hmm.
You ended with a very positive note that what possibilities are there regarding the dialogue and other things that Habermas talked about in Indian context. But I think then we should also think that Eurocentrism question that has cropped up regarding Habermas and others. So if we think of imagining some dialogue in the Indian context, then this intersubjectivity, we also talk about that inter-community dialogue, because intersubjectivity implied in Habermas is based on basically on individuals.
Yeah.
So naturally, if you situate it in an Indian context, so some kind of communitarian understanding of justice must be brought in it. And also I think that then the question of a life world also should be interpreted in a different perspective, because one major critic is that there are thinkers who argue that the critical Marxist thinkers that everyday life has been banished, a kind of argument from Latin American. I have in mind Martha Arnecker's argument that everyday life has been banished from politics. So how to integrate everyday life politics again? So if the every question of everyday life, a revival of everyday life in politics is to be posed, so naturally the question of life world should be posed in a different light, rather than that life world prejudiced and some kind of coming out of the life world in an enlightened. So naturally this binary should be questioned also.
Any further question?
Yes, yes, please, please, please.
One just rectification. You said regarding categorical imperative that it should it is subjective. But for Kant, categorical imperative was totally objective. Because for him, this categorical imperative, it should be applied to all. Because when you were thinking of whether you should keep the money bag with yourself or you should just leave it like that, so there you should think about all the situation or all the circumstances, whether you would like to apply that thing to all situations. So categorical imperative, it presupposes a kind of universalizability, like whether when we are talking, like you should speak the truth, whether speaking the truth or to tell the truth, you want it to be universalizable in all contexts. Because not in all contexts, speaking the truth will be the, you will be doing the right thing. So here also regarding this categorical imperative, Kant has suggested it is not subjective because reason, when you are applying reason to these ethical norms, you have to have it universalized. So there is a kind of objectivity in this categorical imperative.
Okay.
Okay.
Yes.
It implies the concept of hospitality, which is conditional. But actual hospitality is unconditional. How does he contextualize it? Actual hospitality.
Okay. Okay, let me very briefly respond to. I start off with the question raised by Shamusri, this categorical imperative. Yes, you are absolutely right. That is this categorical imperative, the notion, it may be objective, all right. But whether I will be guided by the notion of categorical imperative or not, or you will be guided by the notion, is it not subjective? I am just referring to. I think this is what Hegel actually, the distinction made by Hegel between the private notion of morality and the collective notion of social ethics. That is the.
But how do you then reconcile it with his notion of moral autonomy? Yeah, that is one problem. But when he's talking of categorical imperative, he's not saying it
but
is
that,
subjective.
But can there be in Kant really a collective notion of categorical imperative?
No, he does not say so. He does not say so. That is a problem. That is a difficulty in Kant's ethics. That is what you're absolutely right.
Anyway, okay, that is a good intervention. Regarding this first question, that is... two questions, in fact. This utopian understanding of Habermas, that the question that you... One has to do it. One has to go for this exercise. That is, one has to locate these pockets in history where you can possibly think of, say, realizing at least... some of the elements implied in Habermas's project. But I still think, say, independent of space and time, ahistorically, whether it is possible to... One can go for this exercise, of course. So far as the importance of the project is concerned, it's very, very important. But how can you realize it? Who will do it? That is very much contingent that way. And the other question, this is precisely what I tried to do, that is At one point, say, I think Derrida and Habermas, despite their apparent differences, well, there is a possibility of arriving at, in fact, one can say perhaps you are quite right that Derrida is perhaps revising his old original and going back. This actually reminds me of later Althusser also. Althusser's later writings, which are, have now been published, that these also reveal that Althusser in his later writings is has completely changed, going back to a kind of understanding which just does not fit in with his initial structuralist notion. So this happens in the case of, say, great minds. I think it happens. You revise and you continuously change, you continuously shift. So that is, I think, the remarkable, say, beauty of the great mind. Regarding, this is a very, very important point which Arup Sen has raised. That is, in countries like not only India, say, in the non-Western societies, in fact, when you are talking of, say, intersubjectivity, intersubject dialogue, you have to perhaps think in terms of intercommunity dialogue. So intercommunity interaction, intercommunity negotiation. But I do not know, this is very important, but how can you do it? Who will do it? This remains a very big question, but its importance, definitely. It has got to be acknowledged. And this issue is actually, to me also, it's not very clear. That's his whole notion of this life world, everyday life, the way Habermas uses these notions. It's not really very, very, very clear what exactly is meant by that, particularly this tension between system and everyday life, life world, how the system colonizes the life world. And by system, of course, he has in mind the system of capitalist modernity, how it distorts the life world, how it actually takes away the essence of the life world. So that problem remains in Habermas. But as I said, Habermas is putting before us a kind of alternative blueprint, the parameters of which he has just very briefly, theoretically, he has sketched, worked out. But how can they be real? And I also do not know, say, independent of time and space, whether it is possible. And I think Habermas is not interested in doing that also. That is, he has just sketched an alternative blueprint. That is, the directions are given. You should go for a dialogue, you should go for a project of universal pragmatics, you should go for a kind of intersubjective communication. But how it will be done, how it will be worked out, what will be the strategy, whether the strategy of hermeneutics, that will be enough, how the this tension between system and life world, that will be bridged, I think that will vary from, country to country, society to society. And Habermas has, and therein lies the element of utopia in Habermas. He has worked out a blueprint. Now it is for you to apply it, if one thinks that it is applicable. And this last question, this hospitality. Actually, Derrida's notion is something like this, that when you are giving, that is, there can be two kinds of hospitality. One hospitality is conditional hospitality. It is like the idea of, say, this that I tolerate you. That is, you are hospitable, I am welcoming you. You are coming, my doors of my house are open for you. So you are welcome. But when you are welcome on the condition that you have to observe the rules, you have to observe the norms, etc., etc. So that is actually the idea of conditional. Conditional hospitality is almost equivalent to tolerance. But where I do not say, ask any question, no questions asked, that is, you are just welcome. You may be a stranger, but you are welcome. I welcome you. You are my guest, that's all. No, in that sense, that is, even if say in the case of stranger, say you are, I find that you are distressed. I'm just giving you an example. I find that you are suffering, you are distressed. I bring you home, and thereby I welcome you. So I do not lay down any rules or anything. But in another case, it may so happen that, yes, I know you. Partially, I know you. And I welcome you. My doors are open. You can come to my place through some, whatever be the contact, whatever be the reason, you are welcome. You come to my place. But you have to, it is implied, you have to observe certain rules. He or she also knows that certain rules have to be observed. But in another case, I do not know you. You are a stranger, but you are most welcome. So that kind of difference, that is, and Derrida makes it quite clear, that is, tolerance and intolerance and conditional hospitality, they are very, 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 very closely interlinked. But real hospitality means absolutely unconditional. Now, whether it, you are right, whether it is really possible, whether you can really welcome a complete stranger, whether that kind, that way unconditional hospitality is possible, whether it is affordable.
But can there be unconditional hospitality in any sense? Because there are certain rules
Certain rules are that question is there, always there. Anyway, any further question, or we are totally exhausted? yes, please.
Reason and optimism, which is very much present in Habermas, but not present in the older generation of the Frankfurt School. Is it that the earlier generation, they were very deeply rooted in Freud, and they had a kind of Freudian pessimism inherent in them, whereas Habermas, you seldom find any reference to Freud in Habermas's writing. Is Freud a factor? Because for the earlier generation, Freud was a very serious factor. Freud and Marx, and somewhat they were, they tried to combine both, but they tilted more towards Freud, it seems, and the pessimism crept in. Whereas in Habermas, reason is celebrated everywhere, and a kind of optimism creeps in. Is Freud a factor?
You are possibly right, and maybe possibly wrong. I do not know the I do not know the answer, because actually it's not perhaps right that Habermas is has not mentioned Freud. Habermas is also at different points he has said yes. There are references to Freud in his dialogues, particularly that yes I admire Freud, and in fact I have not touched upon that dimension. In Habermas's, many of the dialogues of Habermas, there are very long references to psychoanalysis. Long references to psychoanalysis. And Habermas gives many illustrations from psychoanalysis, because the consideration is different. Habermas is talking of psychoanalysis because of his inclination towards science. When he talks of the importance of science in understanding or in relating science and the life world, so he is talking of the importance of psychoanalysis. He is talking of Freud. So Freud is there. But, and that's why I said that you are possibly right and possibly wrong. On this point, maybe you are wrong, but on another point, you are possibly right. That Habermas does not share the kind of pessimism that gets into the, say, understanding of the early Frankfurt School theory, which come from their, say, their notion of reason, their combination of, say, reason and Freud. But this is something which you come across, say, in Adorno quite strongly, to some extent Horkheimer, in a different way, although a Marxist in Marcuse, when Marcuse talks about one-dimensional man and all these things. That is, I think, their disillusionment with capitalism. And their further understanding that vis-a-vis capitalism and fascist authoritarianism, there is at the moment no visible alternative. So that perhaps led to the Horkheimer's understanding of fascism, for example, this whole notion of mass culture. On that level, yes, I think Freud is quite important when they are talking of this mass culture, mass psychology, and all these things. So the psychological dimension, it is there, this notion of the unconscious over which you don't have any control. So that way, in fact, Freud is and is not there, perhaps, in Habermas.
And since science has been taken as the paradigm, so you have the natural science dichotomy between the natural science and the humanistic and the human science. Yeah. And the life world, the notion itself has been taken from Husserl.
Yeah.
Husserl.
Absolutely.
So he is influenced by so many philosophers.
Oh, yes,
and
yes.
I mean...
Absolutely. No, I did not go into this because then you have to explain what is phenomenology and all these Husserl and everything. So I did not go into that. Yes. Habermas, actually, he is a synthesis of all these. And this is my personal feeling that maybe he has tried to synthesize so many currents which are at cross purposes, that the kind of alternative project that he has tried to build up, well, it is difficult actually to make it really convincing to others. Maybe, I'm not sure. Because you gave it all these elements there. You have phenomenology, you have Marxism, you have structural functionalism. So you have post-structure, everything is there. So very, very difficult. But I would say that it's a very daunting project. Very bold, very daunting, very powerful. And he's an encyclopedic mind. There is no doubt about that. And that's why I said at the very beginning that when you start working on Habermas, it is difficult to say where to begin and where to end. The beginning, perhaps you can identify, the end, because he's still writing and lecturing and everything. So he remains an unfinished project that way. Habermas himself remains an unfinished project. So, anyway, any further intervention or... So, you can...
Before I thank you, sir, I would still like to continue as I requested to you all, to have a short open forum discussion. Yeah, pardon? Yeah. On what you have really... what is your feeling? What do you like to express on the whole series? You have concluded just now. That, of course, has been a very rewarding experience for me personally. But I would expect from you not only praising words, but also very critical, to be very critical and come up with new suggestions and new ideas which we could implement, which at least try to implement. So we make it very informal, and we can also speak Bangla, English, and make it very, like really an adda. Sorry. Pardon? Writing it to hoye gache writing money, okay, lingering mane kobe likhbo ki korbo ami chaichi eta ekhane ekta open shobai very openly apnara bolun please feel free to talk, please come ki apnader experience and bhalo kharap everything very open and amra in future what we could really do for you it's very important for us. I mean, I have few of you have already responded. I think 9 or 10 participants. I would request first.
Before we start talking, I have to say just one or two things to you. That is, I must say all these things because this is the last opportunity of talking to you in such a forum. That is, for me, I must say that it has been a very, very rich and rewarding experience. Rich and rewarding experience for two reasons. One is that I have learnt a lot from these sessions. Many things which I did not know, well, I had very superficial understanding, so I enriched myself. So for me that was a rewarding experience. The other thing is that I must congratulate and thank all of you, because the way you have responded, and this morning I was just telling him that it was something which I just could not anticipate. In September 2013, when this program was launched, I really was in two minds, and I was, frankly speaking, I was very much scared, because such heavy stuff, well, how people will respond to it? And for more than 2 years, it's going on, braving our heat, our monsoon, our water logging, and all these things. Yes, Saraswati Pujo and all these. But we were just assessing the sheets that in all the sessions there has been a steady, say, intake of about 30 plus 30 35. So this is something remarkable. I so it was very, very I did not at least imagine, I could not imagine that this will happen. But the way you have responded, and the most important thing is that you have not come here as just passive listeners. That's coming here and you pick up your file and then you go. It has not happened like this. So, and in a city of Kolkata, with all its problems, anxieties, uncertainties, and all these, the way you have come and you have responded, you have so actively, this proactive role of the participant, that was really, really encouraging, for me at least. So this is my personal word of thanks to all of you. And so you now, please.
I perhaps look at Sudeshna first, because you also have responded to my request when you started.
Well, two things.
I can't touch with that.
No, so
that people can
series to have taken place. And as I was sharing this with Parthuda over tea a couple of hours ago, when I was a student still, I remember how Max Mueller Bhavan introduced me to this world of Western classical music that I was with some trepidation trying to enter. And at that point of time, Dr. Peter Zevitz, who was director here and a very great musicologist, he initiated a series of lectures on appreciating Western classical music. And I was so, so enriched with those lectures. And at that point of time, people like Kishore Chatterjee and Dr. Adi Gazdar and Bulbul Sarkar, Dr. Zevitz himself, of course, because at that point of time in mid-90s, we didn't have access to so much of music that we could hear and read about, and the Max Mueller Bhavan library at that point of time was such a rich repository. So I was very, very, you know, excited when this series started after a long, long time. And if I could put a few suggestions about how the series could continue, if we can take these series of lectures as an introductory or, you know, a primary source of our acquaintance with these philosophers, if we could identify certain texts which have been, some have been studied, some, you know, texts have been circulated, take up one text maybe, things are available on PDF, you can download stuff. We read that text. And then we come to a master class where a text is studied in very great detail. I think that would be a very, very useful way to continue this series of, the German intellectual tradition lectures could take another incarnation maybe. And as I have already submitted my responses to the link that had been circulated by Parthoda here, I am also reminded about a series of lectures that on German expressionist period, the German expressionism, which was taken by Professor Shomik Bondopadhyay long, long time ago. And that, a second part of that translated into early German cinema, where expressionist artists were directly going into early German cinema and doing the sets for the films and all that. So, I mean, I have indicated in greater detail in my response sheet, but these are, Dr. Macker is there, so, I mean, you know, these are some things. And the last one is, if a series of lectures could be started on classical music, you know, Western classical music and the German tradition, and the atonal period, we don't know so much about, because that requires a special kind of training. You need to develop a taste for that. The classical, the Baroque, and in the early music, early church music, yes, one is familiar with. But what about the new experiments that are, coming out in the classical music scene now, is something that we don't know much about. So that is something I would be really interested in. And if that could be done in association with Calcutta School of Music, all the better, because they would have a lot of resource persons do lectures on. And there is, you know, so much of music already in the library, and, you know, we could draw on that as well. So these were, I wanted to share these things with you. Thank you.
First of all, this was really an enriching experience for all of us, definitely, because in our classrooms we.
Sir, but take and please announce your name. I think
that I'm Rita Banerjee. This has been a very enriching experience for all of us, I'm sure, because I'm a student of political science, and we have. In our university curriculum, we had the names of Kant and Nietzsche in our, the coursework, but we were not taught anything about it. Now I think recently they are being taught, but we were not taught. So it was definitely an enriching experience, because we learned about the later German the tradition without knowing the beginning. And so I would definitely like this series to continue in. Maybe continue from here onwards. And as Sudeshna said, I think if we can arrange for some a particular section. These have been broad overviews. A particular, you know, a thrust on a particular area. Get some resource person to have an intensive type of lecture like we have now, the same time, but on a particular area, not on the broad theme. Since we have already had an overview of the broad themes, to select some areas and have some lectures on that. But definitely, I would like this to continue, you know. And in, if there are some other new formats in which it can be done, that's fine with us.
You said go more into detail, maybe take one text and then prepare that and discuss it more in detail. In that respect, would you think of still sticking to the philosophers, or would that be, because you also mentioned other areas, music, film, whatsoever. Like in, would you rather prefer to go now more into detail within the philosophers that have been dealt with here so far, or opening it up?
For me, what I would say is that what she says, Sudeshna says about music and film, those will be entirely new subjects. So those would require, I think, again the broader scope. But since we have already covered the series on philosophers, so I suppose the participants who have been coming here more or less will be the same. So they'll be familiar with what has happened. And you have put the lectures up on YouTube. So those which we have missed, we can always go back to YouTube and look at that. But if we can take up some intensive study of those philosophers, while also thinking of the broad ones of music and cinema, of course. But since we are familiar with this ground, it would be helpful, I think, for a greater understanding of the subject.
And you know, in when we are, if we are again doing this philosophers, maybe some particular aspects, if a little more focus could be put on political philosophy. Since I am a student of political science, that is always very more interesting to me. So, you know, those philosophers like Max Weber, Marx, they had quite a lot of political ideas. So for them, like if a little bit of focus could be put, then it would be great.
And just another thing is that just as today sir was talking of the debates between, you know, the two philosophers. Yeah, so there have been a lot of debates in the German intellectual tradition. So we can always have those also as part of the, you know, the learning process.
Certain debates, if yes, they could be discussed.
Ashisa. আমার নাম আশিস লাহিড়ি। আমি আপনাদের কাছে এত কৃতজ্ঞ যে আমি সত্যি কথা বলতে ভাষায় গুছিয়ে বলতে পারছি না। এখানে যেসব বিষয়ে আলোচনা হলো তার অধিকাংশ বিষয়ে আমার খুবই ভাষা ধারণা ছিল। যেমন আমি হ্যাবারমাস নিয়ে আমি আজকে একটাও কথা বলিনি এই জন্য যে আমি কিচ্ছু জানি না ব্যাপারটা, কিন্তু আজকে আমি যেটা জানলাম এটা কিন্তু আমাকে ডেফিনেটলি এই বিষয়ে আরও পড়াশুনো করতে উদ্বুদ্ধ করবে, এতে কোনো সন্দেহ নেই। আর সাজেশনের দিক থেকে আমি এইটা বলবো যে এরকম যদি করা যায় যে যারা যারা বললেন এতদিনের এতে যারা যারা লেকচার দিয়েছেন, আমার মনে যদি কোনো প্রশ্ন জাগে তো আমি ওভার ইমেল আই ক্যান সেন্ড দোজ কোয়েশ্চেন্স টু দি পার্টিকুলার লেকচারার্স অ্যান্ড দে ক্যান রেসপন্ড ইফ এ সিস্টেম লাইক দ্যাট ক্যান বি ইভলভড। এটা এটা একটা মনে হয়। আরেকটা যেটা মনে হচ্ছিল যে যেরকম ফিলোসফি নিয়ে হলো এটা সাহিত্য নিয়েও বোধ হয় করা যায়, এবং আমি এইটা বলতে চাইছি not a general discussion but based on reading. For example, Goethe, Faust. You read Faust and then you explain where lies the real greatness of Faust. If such sessions can be arranged for, people like me would be very much grateful. Thank you.
Well, like everybody, I would also like to thank the library for arranging such a good series of lectures, such a brilliant set of lectures. Well, I would just like to say one thing. Some of the German thinkers have been left out. Can we arrange another series including them?
Please.
Yeah, I'm not sure.
Actually, though I have deep doubts about the project of enlightenment, but still I should say that I myself have benefited a lot from the discussions. Frankly speaking, I do not have any formal training in philosophy, and I am also an intruder in the field of social science, because science knows that I do not have any training in social science, so I do some work at the margins of social science. But I am benefited in a sense that if one attends some formal classes in philosophy, so I think that that is a very claustrophobic world, so in that way it is very difficult for people like us who do not want to be that much formal in go through the formal process. But this is an interactive session, so naturally I have been initiated with a lot of ideas and the whole tradition in a systematic manner, or also systematic at the same time informal interactive manner. So I think that that is very important. And there, in regarding my suggestions, I should say that there are many suggestions that have already come forward. Yeah, but I think that the German political philosophy may be focused and some important texts may be taken into consideration for text-centric discussion may be arranged. And particularly I think that what the name which comes to my mind is Rosa Luxemburg. So she was a great dreamer, and I should say that her writings are still important from various perspectives. So I am not talking about Rosa only. So if, because most of the students come here having training in, formal training in political science. So for the larger audience, I think that if political philosophy be the central theme and not such this kind of general, we have already initiated with the long tradition. So next political philosophy discussion, it would be better if some texts are selected and that are circulated in advance, and then the lectures are organized around those texts, so that the discussion will be more fruitful, I think. Thank you.
I think at least some major, very major philosophers or psychoanalysts, they have been left out, especially Jung. Omitting Jung is something not good. When you discuss Freud, you have to discuss Jung. You cannot do away with Jung. He's such a stalwart. And no, there is a politics. There is a politics of pressing Freud and remaining silent about Jung. And Adler, of course. And Eric Fromm, Herbert Marcuse. They are great in their own right. So I think if you arrange another series, that will be great.
Just for your for your information, we had two sessions on Carl Gustav Jung, and we have present, not part of this program, but already before, we presented two books. Yes, that was a, yeah, but, yeah.
Jung in India.
Jung in India was wonderful.
Okay, so, well, I'm Arijit Mukherjee, and as we have come to an end of a series of lectures on German philosophers, I would agree with many that we can obviously go for an in-depth study or a closer reading of the texts. And I may also agree with some of the people who are saying that, well, we can move from these philosophers to other traditions. Obviously, there are overlapping areas, like if we you know, go through the history of music or art. But as we have come to the end of this series, and which is focusing on philosophy, we can look at these other paradigms while focusing on the influence of philosophy on these other paradigms. So in that way, there will be both a vertical and horizontal movement, and perhaps, you know, we can be more enriched having a source point. So this is my opinion about the whole thing. Thank you.
আমার নাম সুহেন্দু ভট্টাচার্য। যে কথা প্রায় প্রত্যেকেই বলছেন যে স্যার অর্থাৎ ডক্টর শোভনলাল দত্তগুপ্তের কাছে আমাদের প্রত্যেকেরই কৃতজ্ঞ থাকা উচিত। এত দিন ধরে এত যত্ন নিয়ে উনি সমস্ত অনুষ্ঠানটা পরিচালনা করেছেন, এবং যারা বলবেন তাদের সঙ্গে যোগাযোগ করা, এবং তারপরে এমএমবির যারা এখানে কাজ করেছেন তাদের প্রত্যেককে আমাদের কৃতজ্ঞতা জানানো উচিত। আসলে রাসেল সম্ভবত প্রথম একটি পার্থক্য করেন বিটুইন পপুলার ফিলোসফি অ্যান্ড প্র্যাকটিক্যাল ফিলোসফি, এবং ফিলোসফিকে পপুলার করার জন্য কিছু লেখা লিখতে আরম্ভ করেন। আমার ধারণা ফিলোসফির মধ্যে একটা চট করে টেনে নেওয়ার আকর্ষণ ক্ষমতা আছে, অন্তত প্রথম দিকে এ সহজ, যার জন্য উই পিপল নন একাডেমিক স্ফিয়ার থেকে যারা আসছি তারা আকৃষ্ট হই। অ্যান্ড প্রথম দিকে আমি কান্ট এবং ইমানুয়েল কান্ট এবং মার্কসের উপর লেকচার মিস করেছিলাম। পার্থবাবু আছেন, আপনাকে মেলে হয়তো আমি আমার হতাশাও জানিয়েছিলাম, খবর পাইনি। সাম মোর সাজেশনস, আই থিঙ্ক দেয়ার আর টু ডিসিপ্লিনস, ইট সিমস টু বি এট অল ক্লেম, ওয়ান ডিসিপ্লিন ইজ ফিলোসফি অফ সায়েন্স, অ্যান্ড উই মাস্ট নট ফরগেট স্যার কার্ল রেমন্ড পপার, ফর ইউ স্যার। অ্যান্ড নাম্বার টু, দেয়ার অলসো উই নো আওয়ার জার্মান ইকোনমিক ট্র্যাডিশন ইন দ্য লাইন উইথ জোসেফ শ্রামফিটার। আই রিপিট, ইট সিমস টু বি এট অল ক্লেম, বাট সাম নন অ্যাম্বিয়েন্স ক্লাসরুম লাইক দিস ওয়ান অ্যান্ড ইনসাইড দ্য MMB লাইব্রেরি, ইট উড বি এ গ্রেট এক্সপিরিয়েন্স ফর আস। থ্যাংক ইউ অল অফ ইউ।
আমি নিতব্রত, ভূগোলের ছাত্র। দর্শন বিষয়টা আমাদের কাছে একটা অন্যরকম অভিজ্ঞতা, কিন্তু আমি এখানে এসে অনেক কিছু শিখেছি। বিশেষত এই বয়সে শেখাটা একটা বড় ব্যাপার, এবং অন্য বিষয়ভিত্তিক পড়াশোনা। আমি আপনাদের কাছে কৃতজ্ঞ, এবং আমার বন্ধুবর অরিজিতের কাছেও কৃতজ্ঞ, প্রথম লিঙ্কটা দিয়েছিল। এই সুযোগে আমি একটু ধন্যবাদও জানালাম এখানে। অ্যান্ড মাই সাজেশন ইজ দ্যাট ইউ শুড ফোকাস অন রিসেন্ট জার্মান গ্রিন পলিটিক্স, পার্টিকুলারলি দ্য ওয়ার্কস অফ পেট্রা কেলি অ্যান্ড আদার গ্রিন লিডার্স অফ জার্মানি অ্যান্ড উইলি ব্ল্যান্ট অফ সোশ্যাল ডেমোক্রেট মুভমেন্ট, অ্যান্ড দে হ্যাভ সাম রাইটিংস। অ্যান্ড অ্যানাদার থিং ইজ দ্যাট সাম জার্মান ফিলোসফার্স অলসো ইন স্পেশাল সায়েন্স, পার্টিকুলারলি ইন আর্ট সায়েন্স, মেইনলি দ্য আলেকজান্ডার ভন হামবোল্ট, কার্ল রিটার, ফেডরিক র্যাডজেলস, দে শুড ইনক্লুড আই থিঙ্ক ইন দ্য নেক্সট সেশন।
হ্যালো, আমার নাম তপন ভট্টাচার্য। আমি খুবই কৃতজ্ঞ আপনাদের সবার কাছে যে এরকম একটা সেশন হলো। আমার সাজেশন হচ্ছে যে একটা যেটা খুব ইম্পর্ট্যান্ট সেটা হচ্ছে জার্মান ফিলোসফি আমরা যেভাবে রিড করলাম তাতে যেটা খুব ইম্পর্ট্যান্ট সেটা হচ্ছে যে ওরা একটা পোস্ট মডার্ন যে রিয়েলিটিটা বিল্ড আপ করেছিল ইউরোপ এবং পোস্ট টেরার অ্যাটাকসে যে রিয়েলিটিটা বিল্ড আপ করেছিল সেই বিল্ড আপে ইন্টারভিন করতে চাইছে, যে ফিলোসফিটাকে একটা অ্যাবস্ট্রাক্ট সাবজেক্ট না রেখে ওইটাকে ইন্টারভিনিং করতে চাইছে ইন্টু দ্য লাইফস অফ ম্যান এবং ইন্টু দ্য আর্টস অফ ম্যান। এইটা খুব ইম্পর্ট্যান্ট একটা জায়গা, যার ফলে হয়েছে কি অনেক সময় যেমন আজকের লেকচারেও আমার বারবারই মনে হচ্ছিলো যে এই যে পোস্ট মডার্ন কন্ডিশনের কথা আমরা বলছি, তখন যদি কিছু ভিজুয়াল আর্টসে যে মডার্ন কন্ডিশন থেকে পোস্ট মডার্ন কন্ডিশনে যে শিফট হচ্ছে, এই শিফটগুলো অন্তত ভিজুয়ালি দেখার দরকার রয়েছে যে এক্স্যাক্টলি কী ঘটছে। তার কারণ হচ্ছে পোস্ট ওয়ার জার্মান পেইন্টিং হচ্ছে এক্সট্রাঅর্ডিনারি একটা অ্যাচিভমেন্ট। আমি বাসলি, স্কিফার, কিপেনবার্গার, মারিয়া লাসিং এবং আরও অনেকের নাম করতে পারি, বা জার্মান ফটোগ্রাফি গার্সকি, এখানে এই সব বই রয়েছে। দ্যাট জাস্ট সাচ এ গ্রেট অ্যাচিভমেন্ট। আপনারা শুন, এটা হয়েছে ওই একটা হিউজ ট্রমা মানুষকে একটা অদ্ভুত একটা হিউম্যান সেন্সিটিভিটি দেয়, যে সেন্সিটিভিটি শরিক হচ্ছে এই জার্মান আর্টিস্টরা, সেটা আমার মনে হয়। এবং এই জার্মান আর্টিস্টদের সাথে এই ফিলোসফিক্যাল অ্যাপ্রোচগুলোর বিচিত্র সব যোগ রয়েছে। কিফারের সঙ্গে যেভাবে হাইডেগার বা সেলানের যে যোগগুলো রয়েছে, এইগুলো এখানে অনেক সময় আমরা ভিজুয়ালি মিস করছি, এক্স্যাক্ট পয়েন্ট হয়তো লিটারেলি জানছি। যেমন আজকে যেমন ইন্টারটেক্সচুয়ালিটির প্রসঙ্গটা, আমার মনে হচ্ছে আমরা যদি ভিজুয়াল আর্টসই ইন্টারটেক্সচুয়ালিটি কী কী চেঞ্জ নিয়ে এলো, আমি কি দেখছি ডিফারেন্টলি, দ্যাট কুড বি মাচ, মানে ভিজুয়ালি জিনিসটা হয়ে গেলে ক্ল্যারিটি উড বিগিন, ক্ল্যারিটি উড কামিং। সেটাই, এইটাই যা সাজেশন রইল যে এরপরে এই জিনিসটা ভাবতে পারেন। আর এটা কিন্তু একটা ইম্পর্টেন্ট ই যে পোস্ট ওয়ার জার্মান ভিজুয়াল আর্টস হচ্ছে একটা এক্সট্রাঅর্ডিনারি অ্যাচিভমেন্ট। ঠিক আছে, থ্যাংক ইউ।
To that one question, would you then concentrate really only on the modern artists, or if you talk of this merging of philosophy and the arts, or would you then again revisit starting from Kant? I mean, both would be possibilities.
That can be done, sir. That can be done, but mostly I will try after the post-war scenario. Because the post-war scenario gave a extreme philosophical artistic vacuum which they filled up, and so within that context, if we read it instead of enlarging into it from say Durer and from other artists, from Guignard or Cranch, then it would be elaborated extremely bigger. But thing is, if we just after post-war if we start, then I think it clarity would much be apparent. Thank you.
Thank you, Doctor. Please, বলুন কি, what do you expect, what was wrong,
nothing,
what was good.
I would first express my deep gratitude. It was a fantastic experience because I joined much later, and it was a fantastic experience and definitely a learning experience. Almost every suggestion has been put forward, possible suggestion. I was just wondering about one thing. Would it be possible, because this is a policy matter as far as I assume so, would it be possible if the language of lecture can also be Bengali apart from English? Because if, in that case, if I'm not wrong and if I'm not biased, it would expand the catchment of resource persons. And with matter of uploading it in the YouTube, on YouTube, there can always be subtitles. So that cannot be, because we have Derrida's interviews or even Habermas's interviews subtitled in English. So that may not be a problem. I was just thinking, because it would increase, or rather expand, increase wouldn't be the right term, expand the catchment of the resource person.
From the part of organized, it is absolutely possible, but I would request Dr. Datta Gupta to respond to that question, if it will be easier, or it will be easier to get more resource persons on these topics in Bangla.
I have to explore. I do not know. Because actually, finding out that this all these resource persons for about 2.5 years. Yes, it is true that whoever be the resource person, whenever I made any request, they immediately obliged. That was my luck, I would say. But I do not know whether it will be repeated this time also. And your suggestion is most welcome. That is, Bengali knowing, but. And I would just like to add one point, that is, all the suggestions that you have given are very, very important, most welcome. But the main problem is to find out the right kind of resource person. That is the main problem. It was really hell of a job for me to find out all these resource persons across the state. And in two cases, we have to bring in resource persons from outside also. And thanks to the director's initiative, actually it was possible that yes, two persons can be brought from outside. But there is a paucity of resources. That is a major problem. Especially, you know it very well, this requires very specialized kind of understanding. And I really do not know. But we have to explore. If it is possible, of course it will be done.
Can I dare make another suggestion? And I think that Professor Datta Gupta is not going to thank me for this. I think almost all of us would agree on this. If Professor Datta Gupta starts a series of master classes,
my God.
I am not his direct student. I am not his direct student. So I have been a student of literature, and today I was almost what, no, taken back. Yeah, at least once a month. At least once a month, because I'm a student of literature. Because we would really want an orientation of and people who are already trained in philosophy to be his direct students. So,
in that point, I'd request Mr. Maker to comment. Please come up with a suggestion, something.
No. I think for me personally, obviously, it's very important to get your feedback. So thank you very, very much for that. The other point that I feel is very important is, and there I have to contradict you a little bit, Professor Datta Gupta. I don't think at this stage one should even consider is it possible or not. For me, this is about brainstorming. It's collecting ideas, seeing what maybe what kind of wishes are there, what is lacking, where is information missing, etc. So at this stage, for me, it's about collecting that from you. Obviously, later we have to sit down, write it down, and see what actually can be done. But at this stage, I think that should not be of concern, is it possible or not? So every idea is welcome, and then we'll discuss it and see what we actually can do.
So we can hope for a series of master classes.
Well, probably from all the suggestions, there is no doubt about it that how effective this particular series of lectures had been. It was a delightful moment for, I think, many of us to come here as a participant and really being enriched by the lectures. Apart from, so far as the suggestions are concerned, apart from the textual reading, I feel that it would be much better, since I'm from the discipline of political science, if emphasis is being given on political philosophy to a great extent. And in this respect, I believe that if it is at all possible that instead of highlighting on the philosophers, if we could come up with a more thematic, thematic series of lectures, like if we have a particular political theme and then have the philosophers in our mind and then have a really interactive sessions between, so far as the philosophers concerned over those themes or issues are concerned. And regarding the so far as our Professor SDG sir is concerned, I feel that it's definitely a more, it would be a more pleasure, it would be a really a pleasure for us if he actually takes up the forthcoming, in taking up the task of organizing the upcoming series so far. Thank you.
So, should we end here or, sir? Okay.
So, simply to say thank you very, very much again for your constant participation, for your feedback. And I promise that we'll thoroughly discuss it. It might not be something that we can still start this year, We always need a little bit of time, obviously, to prepare things and find resource people, etc. But we'll definitely continue with a couple of your suggestions. So I hope you, as they say in the television, stay tuned. And then we'll, as soon as we come up with ideas, we'll definitely let you know. Thank you very much and have a good evening.